Alright, thank you all for joining. This is the OpenDaylight tutorial session 2 of the 3 sessions. The first session was basically Sini gave us an overview of ODL. Today he will lead us through some app development hands-on experience with ODL. Note that this conference is being recorded. If you do not want to be recorded, please drop out now. Alright, Sini, over to you.
Thanks, Vijay. In yesterday's session, we covered a lot of the platform aspects, and we spent most of the time on NAN modeling because that is such an integral component of OpenDaylight. And today, hopefully, we'll be able to fill in some of the gaps and look at things in a more concrete sense, and also play with a NetConf and an OpenFlow plugin so that you can see how you can use the OpenDaylight platform with external devices. And we will look a little bit more into the Java code and programming aspects today, but initially at least the first hour of it would more focus on functionalities exposed over REST and trying to look at what are the platform implications of some of the features. So let's go ahead and look at what does building an application mean in the context of OpenDaylight. The first thing you do, as I mentioned yesterday, is you have to define the Yang model for whatever state you're going to keep and whatever state you're going to be sending to other modules in the form of like a contract. So the first thing you do is model the data structures in Yang. And second thing you do is you have to write the code for the activation of your specific application through the config subsystem. So each application you build will have two things. Specifically, it will have a Yang model that defines the dependencies and the namespace and other aspects relevant for the configuration of that implementation. And the second thing is an XML file that specifies all the parameters that are relevant for that configuration model. So these two things are provided, and they are loaded at they are checked during compile time, but they are more so verified during runtime, and almost always most beginners get this part incorrect and have challenges with instantiating their application. So we'll see some examples of this so that you can get this done correctly. And it's not rocket science. It's easy enough to figure it out. You can almost always copy from another module and use it for your purposes, just that you need to ensure you appropriately update the namespaces and revision date and stuff like that. And the third step after you get your activation and done is to start implementing the event handler. As I mentioned, OpenDaylight is an event driven system, and anything is going to basically react to notifications from external systems or maybe some input from the end user as a configuration parameter, and all of these have associated callback functions. So essentially you're going to be building a lot of event handling code, and typically this is where the concept of a provider and a consumer starts coming in. A lot of developers in the OpenDaylight world start calling certain applications as providers of certain service and certain applications as consumers of a service. Basically, it all comes down to who's going to be the real master of the data. So if, let's say, a particular class is the one that is going to be managing state, and others are just listening on that state, then typically you would call that the provider. And a provider is the one that also receives and handles any RPC calls from external applications. And the provider is the one that also publishes any notifications that other listeners want to listen to. And a consumer is the exact opposite. It typically listens for data. I think I have a mistake in the slide. Consumer, most people refer to those that listen to data changes, and it makes RPC calls, and it also listens to notifications coming from other providers. And most of this difference between a provider and consumer is very subtle. Most applications you build could be a provider of one service where it's a consumer of another service. So let's just know what it is, but not worry too much about what these are. And Vijay, before
just
we started the
question there, the notion of a provider and a consumer in terms of the data seems inverse to what I would have expected, right? I mean, I would have expected that the provider is the one that generates data and the consumer is the one that consumes it. Here you seem to be saying the opposite.
Yeah, I mentioned I have a mistake on this, right? So, yeah, it's the opposite. You're right.
Sorry. I wasn't paying attention.
Yeah. Sorry. Vijay also asked another question before the session started on what is the difference between a plugin and an application. And this was also asked by another colleague of yours towards the end of last session. Plugin, typically, at least language or terminology wise, I would see as something that interacts with an external system so that it provides some abstraction to higher level modules which want to use the system. So otherwise, really a plugin is just another application you would write. So let's look at an example of a consumer. And here I have a consumer that is basically listening for any changes in the OpenFlow inventory, which means that a new switch was discovered or a new port was discovered. And for that, what I would do is I would first register this particular class, which I'm calling as consumer impulse, as the listener for the notification from notification service. And here I have this keyword here saying implement OpenDaylight inventory listener. Now this term here is basically a Java interface that is automatically generated by Yang tools once we define the OpenDaylight.yang model. And if you remember from yesterday's session, OpenDaylight.yang model had four notifications defined. One was node updated, node removed. Other was node connector updated, node connector removed. So once you have these four notifications defined in the Yang model and you compile it using Yang tools, it will generate this Java interface called OpenDaylight Inventory Listener. And anyone that registers as a listener will have to do this operation. Will have to register themselves as a notification listener. And once that happens, they're going to start getting callbacks for this on-node updated function. So whenever you want to listen to any inventory changes, this is simplest thing you could do, register your class as a notification listener and it should implement the OpenDaylight inventory listener and then you start receiving callbacks. So then your task is a lot simpler. Whenever a new switch appears in your network, you just have to write the appropriate code to handle this particular callback function. Now in this case, let's say as an operation, let's say the consumer now wants to delete all the existing flows in that switch, which is a common thing most controllers try to do. Then I would use a handle to a RPC function or the flow service. So here again, this consumer is getting a handle to the flow service by doing a get RPC service function call. And once I get a handle on that particular flow service, I can now go about making a RPC callender. And this last line here is basically, says that I want to remove all the flows in that particular switch. So here I'm receiving a callback for a notification and I'm performing a RPC call. And this is typically what a consumer would do. And let's look at the a provider. Now a provider here is going to be so here actually I do have a flip. Okay, I'm actually showing an example of a provider that is reacting to any new configurations that come for a tap. And so in this context, I was seeing this as a provider of tap functionality, which was going to react on any new configurations coming for tap. So the first thing I did was I registered this class as a data change listener for any tap configuration. And once that configuration is sent from the end user or administrator using RESTCON, then automatically the on data change callback is called. So the main takeaway I want to show from both of these slides is that essentially all of the code is going to be event driven. You're either going to react to switches coming into your network or some high level service configuration provided by the administrator. And you could also keep tabs on other statistics or other details, saying maybe there is one switch that is having a lot of traffic and we are noticing that its buffer is getting overflown or something like that. Although you would probably be checking the open flow statistics and you can again react on that based on that information. Again, it's in a way it's also another event because you're going to listen for data change on the statistics. So essentially most of the code is going to be event driven, and in this example I have on the screen, I'm showing how a particular a TAP provider, which is essentially TAP is the network or traffic monitoring application, how a TAP provider is going to react to any new configuration coming from the end user. So whenever a data change comes in, it goes about reacting to it. And this TAP provider is also registering itself as a RPC provider for any create TAP call. So if the end user were to either use response and enter data directly to the data store, or use the RPC call and enter to the data store, both of that will have the same impact on having this particular TAP provider being called. And if it's a data change, then the on data change will be called. But if it's a RPC, then the create TAP function will be called. So now a lot of these were actually auto-generated for me. So once I defined the YAN model, this TAP service.class was auto-generated. So all that I had to do is I had to say that this implementation I have on the screen is going to be handling that particular TAP service. And so I registered this particular implementation as the RPC provider for that TAP service. And once I do that, anytime someone calls one of the RPC calls, then the appropriate callback function is called. So this is essentially what a provider would do. And here one thing I want to point out is that an RPC call returns something called as a future. A future is a concept that is very often used in anything that involves transactions. And so now here, this particular function is capable of returning both a status saying whether this particular call succeeded or failed, and also it can provide a lot more data on whatever outcome or result you want to return. So all of this could be sent back to the calling a function. And essentially what they will do is they'll just wait on this future. So they will get, it's like a, they could do a block wait on a particular RPC call, and they could get back a lot of result information back. So these are typically how you would do a consumer or provider. I did try to keep it abstract from in the provider from OpenFlow, because it's possible you often would be doing adaptation between different kinds of configuration data, which may not even have to do anything with OpenFlow. Any questions with these examples? So these are what we will actually look at the code when we bring the TAP application towards the latter part of this session. But before that, I'm going to look at some of the RESTCON stuff and NetCON and other aspects before going to that. Okay, so the important points to note are basically you need to look at the registered data change listener registering an implementation as a RPC service provider and implementing the appropriate callbacks for any data change or any RPC calls. And similarly, there is registering a particular implementation as a notification listener and appropriately implementing the callback function for notification, and getting a handle of any other RPC objects so that you can make RPC calls. So these are all the things that MDSAL will provide for you. And all of this basically go through the registry service or go through the data broker service. These are all basically MDSAL aspects. And this way, when you do these registering listeners and things like that, MDSAL creates a database of who are listening for what events and who are providers for what RPC functions and things like that.
Shini, at the risk of me revealing my lack of Java knowledge in the previous slide, where are you specifying that on node updated is the function that is the callback listener?
So this is actually
standard because you're doing an override.
Yeah, it is standard because in this OpenDaylight inventory listener. So yesterday I showed this piece where on the right hand side, I have these four notifications defined. When I do that, what MDSAL and Yang tools does is that it automatically generates specific listener classes and interfaces, and that interface has a method that has been defined. It has been declared but not really implemented, and the implementation will be in the actual listener.
Okay.
So whenever I have these kind of notifications defined, then the on node updated and is what you would be implementing.
Okay, thanks.
Even actually, so if you use an IDE like Eclipse, when you, as soon as you put this word implement open daylight inventory listener, it will actually force you to write this class or this method.
Okay.
So that way you know that, there is a callback that needs to be handled.
Srini, this is Aman. I have a question.
Yeah.
I joined a little bit late, so maybe you already covered this, but in the provider, why do you have both the data change listener as well as an RPC provider or RPC method?
Good question. So essentially, so when I build a, this is something I've also seen from experience that typically when I'm building a provider of a functionality or a tap service, let's say I'm building an application that's going to configure the traffic monitoring features and underlying open flow switches. And for that tap service, I want to get configuration from the administrator to say what kind of traffic needs to be tapped. But the end user or the administrator can provide me configurations in several ways. He can provide that as a direct input into the config data store, or he can provide that to me as a RPC call. So there are two ways one could provide the configuration. It all comes down to what you want to offer. And typically, if you say I have another, you could do either of that. And in my case, I just wanted the same implementation to handle both of that. So there's no other reason except that I just wanted all my functionality to be in just one single place. So what I would do is I would write a private method that just takes the configuration and sends it to the open flow switch. And I would call that private method from both of these functions here. So that way, whether the user gives me configuration either through a config data store change or through a RPC, I handle it the same way.
I see. Okay. And just out of curiosity, what does at override mean?
So this is a annotation that Eclipse puts in. It just is a reminder for you to say that this function or this method has been declared inside this particular interface, but it needs to be overridden, otherwise it would not work because this is just a basic interface that does not have any implementation for that function.
Okay.
Yeah, just an annotation from Eclipse. It automatically will get added when you implement these interfaces. So I'm not going to go into the SDN environment. So once you download this VN that I have, it has a bunch of Mininets and Wireshark tools already, and it also has a bunch of controllers already installed. And we're going to play with just a simple Mininet topology, which is just a single switch that connects with three hosts. And three hosts are emulated to have these IP addresses of 10.0.0.1.2.3. And each of these basically are network namespaces. And just assuming you have a little bit of familiarity with Mininet. So when I run this particular command here, it's going to spin up one switch connected to three hosts. And this switch is going to look for connecting to a controller on port 6633. And in our example, we'll be using OpenFlow 1.3. So I'll skip this. This is just for if you are going to try to do the hands-on part yourself, it just helps us for you to get familiar with the different commands. So one thing I do want to point out here, just upfront before I go into the, some of the exercises, is I have a distribution of OpenDaylight, or let me call it a project. I have a tutorial project inside the VN, and the tutorial project actually is not trying to download the full distribution, but only just says what dependencies it has. And so when I compile it, it is going to pull all the dependencies and put it all in a particular location. So now let me go to my virtual machine. So inside the VM, I just compiled the virtual machine. I just compiled my tutorial project. Once I did that, when I go into distribution, OpenDaylight graph, I'm going to target. Here you see a few different things. So here is a package which basically packaged up my whole controller with all the dependencies that just my particular project has. It does not have all the features that OpenDaylight distribution would have. It just has only whatever my project needs. And even that can be large based on what all dependencies have. So I have almost 200 megabytes. So I ended up packaging a lot of the netconf and mbcl artifacts because I'm going to be using it. And I also have a copy of that whole Karaf distribution inside this directory call assembly. So here I have a Karaf distribution which has the executable. It also has all the transient data, and also inside the data, or actually we don't have it here, but any persistent data store will actually come here. So whenever I run it and I add configuration, you will see that there's a new directory called journal that will be created. That journal basically is a persistent store. So I will actually do an exercise and show you what is created. But I just wanted to show you this particular project. And typically for new, for beginners, I would recommend you just take this project and make a clone of it, or create a project just based on this, just change the name from SAN hub or whatever to whatever name you want. Because typically Maven can be a little bit complicated for beginners to figure out. It takes some getting used to. So initially I would recommend just copying the POM files and just renaming the project or application name. And then later, once you get the hang of Maven, you can start making more drastic changes to how the project is structured. So now let's go back to the slide. So I'm going to be running individual features that provide certain functionalities. So now let me just kick off my controller. In the controller that I'm running, I have the TAP application installed by default, which consequently will also load its dependency, which is the OpenFlow plugin. So those will already be loaded. But let's try a few more exercises, and we'll install the netconf connector as well and try to play with netconf. Let's skip these. We will also look at Eclipse shortly because that is a very convenient IDE for building this. So the first thing I'm going to show is how does flow programming work in OpenDaylight. And essentially there is an OpenFlow plugin that is available, which supports 1.0 and 1.3. And it uses the same kind of concepts of Yang modeling, where all the flow configurations are modeled in Yang, and that is sent down to the plugin. And the plugin is going to convert that, and it's going to make exact OpenFlow commands that are sent down to the switch. So here is an example of the model or the configuration that you would provide to the OpenFlow plugin for programming a flow. So let me also pick off MiniNet. So I'm just starting MiniNet with a single switch. Yeah, I have just switch S1 and 3 hosts. Now when I start, the hosts can't ping each other because there are no rules available. So, Okay. On the right side, I'm just printing all the rules. There are no rules available right now, and the ping is failing. And let's see what all I have installed. So here are the list of all the teachers. Anything that says X is the one that's running. So I can also do minus I to see what's specifically installed. Now I have OpenFlow plugin already installed, and some basic NetConf is installed for actually the system function. So interestingly, OpenDaylight uses NetConf based configuration even for some internal interfaces for MDSAL management. This is why a lot of people would call OpenDaylight really a NetConf controller, which has support for OpenFlow. And I also have one application that's installed called the TAP app. I can also list all the Java bundles that are installed. Specifically, I'm just listing the SDN hub bundles for the TAP application. I have the implementation and the model have been installed. And there's no learning switch or anything running right now. Now let's try to program a static rule using the OpenFlow plugin. So whenever one thing that I found very useful when I build an application is define the YAML model, and I try to do a run of the functionality just using only restconf, because if something works using sending configuration over the REST interface, then it will also work if you were to send it from an application. So that is my logic, and that is why I almost always test something using restconf before I actually build the application. So let's do that. So here is the two flows I'm going to be sending. The first flow, I apologize for the small font size. The first flow is sending just one flow to here a node called OpenFlow 1, and it is sending it to table 0. And the match action there says any traffic coming on import 1. And I have apply instruction, and the action it has is basically an output action, which says that the output it should send out is port number 2. So anything coming on host 1 should go to host 2, is essentially what this rule is about. And I have it encoded in XML, but it could also be in JSON. And one thing that's very important here is this ID here, because this ID is going to be the key for that particular entry. So if you recollect from yesterday, any flow, open flow rules that I'm going to be adding to a switch, it's actually added as an argumentation, and the argumentation essentially will have a list of flows, and each flow has a key of which ID, which is a string. So now in this example, I have two flows I'm going to be adding. The first flow both of them are going to be added to the node OpenFlow:1, which is basically this one switch that I have, and I'm going to add it to the table 0. And I need to also specify what the flow name is. So here is my URL for the REST API, and it has been very carefully crafted to include the exact pointer. So if you recollect from yesterday, just another quick refresher. Whenever you have a tree, a parent-child relationship inside a tree, each point in the tree has a particular URL which is denoted by the namespace, followed by the container name, followed by, if you have a list, then it will be a list name, followed by the key value of that list. I'm using the same mechanism, and I'm crafting the URL for this particular flow information as well. Now, before I send this flow, I'll just show you what flows I already have. I just have a Postman collection, which makes it easy for me to send REST API calls. So let's look at what flows I already have. I'm just going to my VM port 8181, restcon config. I have nothing. If you can see the config store, I have nothing. But if you look at the operational store, there should be something here. Operational store basically are discovered items, so it has the three node connectors that were discovered. One of them is a virtual node connector. And then it has all the OpenFlow details. And here are the table information, but right now there are no table or no flows in there. So I have just details on the operation side and nothing on the config. Now let's go about adding a rule on the config side. And here is the open flow rule I'm going to program. Okay, I sent this rule. Now let me refresh. You can see here that a new rule has been added. And viewing it in XML here makes it a lot easier. You can see exactly what is the structure here. Inside the node, I have a table. And the table is actually a list of tables. So I'm looking at table 0. I have a list of flows. And inside the flow, I have one flow, which is dummy forward. And that just has a pointer to the particular flow that I've inserted, which says that traffic coming on input 1 goes to output 2. Now let's look at the flow that got programmed on the switch. You can see here there's a new flow that got pushed here. It says input 1, action is output 2. The ping still fails because I only have unidirectional flow program. So let me program the other direction as well. Okay, now I program two flows, the reverse as well. And now you see two flows here and the ping starts succeeding. So what I've done is I've added the flow rules that I want to push down to the switch inside the OpenDaylight inventory configuration. And that is picked up as a data change by the OpenFlow plugin. And the OpenFlow plugin parses that information and then sends that as an OpenFlow rule to the switch. So this is where you see that a lot of event-driven programming has already happened. Configuration came to the plugin. Plugin picked it up as a data change notification, and it sent it down to the switch. And then the switch got programmed. I still have not built any application yet. I just use RESCON for programming these rules. Go ahead.
Srini, I have a question.
Yeah.
When you said the plugin picked up, are you talking about the consumer part or the provider part?
So in this case, it is a there is a provider. So yesterday, in the example for the learning switch, I was showing you. I was showing you the OpenFlow plugin. So it actually, so there is a small application inside the plugin project called the Flow Programmer that whenever a configuration is added to the OpenDaylight inventory in the form of a flow, that's picked up by the Flow Programmer as a data change notification. So the Flow Programmer is a provider. But again, I mean, it all comes down to, I just want to emphasize that it's just a language. At the code level, it really does not make too much difference whether something is a provider. So now this flow programmer picked up that configuration, and then it made a RPC call down to the plugin, and that eventually got sent down as a flow mode. So let me come back to the flows I program. So yeah, here is where the flow got programmed, and the ping started working. And so essentially this. When we actually build a, so later part of the tutorial, we'll be building a TAP application, which receives a TAP configuration from end users, and it is going to send a flow to the underlying switch. And for doing that, it is going to use this mechanism, but just that it's not going to use RESCON, but it's going to actually build an application for crafting a flow object and to send it down to the OpenFlow plugin. So we will look at.
I have a question. So one question I have is, right now the flow programmer, which is detecting the changes in the config table, that is provided by default, right? You didn't write that.
That is correct.
Okay.
Sorry about the interruption. There was a screaming newborn. The flow programmer is actually an application that is provided by the OpenFlow plugin project. So in my screen, I do have a lot of code of OpenDaylight. Typically, I mean, I don't encourage people to download individual pieces of code, but sometimes, unfortunately, because of the lack of documentation, the code is the holy grail and you have to look at the code. So here is the OpenFlow plugin code. And inside OpenFlow plugin code, I have, in the applications, I have this forwarding rule manager. This is essentially what I was calling as a flow programmer, FRM, and this is what reacts to the data changes and makes RPC calls to the OpenFlow plugin and programs the switch.
So you could have written this flow programmer by yourself also.
Exactly, I could have done that. And in the earlier, a few slides ago, I was showing an example of how I did a RPC call for removing the flows. I could have very well done another RPC call for adding a flow as well. I just had to create a flow object using this flow builder. And then once I do that, I can send the RPC call. I could directly program a flow.
Okay.
That's another, exactly. So it again already shows you there are a couple of different ways in which you could do things. You can either do RPC or data changes. And the answer is not always straightforward. I think, at least from what I've, from experience, noticed that RPC call is a one-to-one relationship, while data change is one-to-many because there can be multiple listeners for it. So depending on which one makes sense for your service, you would pick and choose whether it should be RPC or it should be a data change. And data change, often you don't really get back any results. So if you have a operation where you need to get back some results, then I would obviously then the RPC is the best way to do that because RPC can return back a result to you. So we just programmed the flow using response, and that kind of shows you an example of how you do flow programming in OpenDaylight, and this is similar to what we would do a little later in the session today. Any other questions to the flow programming piece, open flow programming? So I think the one of the other questions or other challenges that one could have is essentially not knowing exactly what the structure is. Like for instance, if now you need to add a IP address match, what do I do? I mean, if let's say I now have a very simple match which said import one, but what if I need to add an IP address match? It is not as straightforward because now you need to look at either the documentation or you need to go look at the YAN model to see exactly what structure this data should be provided. So just to answer that question, if let's say I do want to have IP address, then I have an example here. I had to say that the traffic belongs to type IP, and then I had to give the IP destination prefix. So this is not necessarily intuitive. It is something that you may have to look at the documentation or the YAML model to know exactly what structure that particular object will take.
So when you say you have to look at the documentation or the YAML model, where would that be typically be available?
So the model is there in OpenFlow plugin. So I can.
So we need to go look into the OpenFlow plugins YAML model to figure out exactly what should be the set of commands we send.
Exactly. You have to do that. Or alternatively, what I do, which we started doing from, so I used to be a committer for the OVSDB project. And in that project, what we did was we started creating a lot of toolkits for making flow programming a lot more easier. Inside the VM that I provided, I have a Maven project. Let me open that in my Eclipse and show it to you. It's called Utils. I have been adding to this, and this has been something that has been a lifesaver for me to not have to look at the YAML model. So we have a bunch of utilities here for the action, instruction, and match. And basically, each of these have a bunch of functions for how can I create a group action, or if I want to create an object for a specific action, then I have all the utilities for that in here, at least the most common one. So these are what I heavily rely on for doing any open flow programming. Usually, looking at a YAML model, it can be time consuming, and it's just simpler just building a one-time utility. Similarly, I also have some utilities for inventory management and for making transactions, and we will use some of this And I encourage you to either reuse these or make your own utilities, because there will be a lot of, at least there's something most people from programming in Java might know. There are a lot of boilerplate code that you'll be doing several times, and that is where it's important to have well-defined utilities that you can reuse. So let's move along. So now I'll go on to the next exercise, which is similar, but just that I'm not programming OpenFlow, but I'm going to be sending a netconf configuration to a device. So here on the left side, I have the current way people do it. Either you have an admin or a bunch of scripts that are sending CLI commands to a Cisco router. And if, let's say, I want to configure a BGP instance, then I would set up as follows. Instead of doing that, I could actually use a netconf orchestration from OpenDaylight, because OpenDaylight has a built-in netconf client. And this is what we're going to do. And to make this, I actually have a very simple, so I'm, just for our exercise purposes, I actually made a simple YAG model for a router, which I have added to a netconf server called Netopia. So I've created a router emulation called Netopia, and it's put inside the VM as a Docker container. So if you go to the VM, so let me actually stop my mini-net and we're done with that. So some of these things I encourage you to try on your own. It is all there in the presentation or also on the tutorial webpage. You can try this. So here I have inside the VM, I have a Netopia image, and Netopia is essentially an open source netconf server and client combined together. And this one, I'm going to be using this to emulate a router. Essentially, I'm going to create an instance of this Netopia, and we're going to all pretend that it's a router. And the YAN model for that Netopia router is right here. I hope you can see my screen. I essentially have a module called router. Inside that, I have a list of interfaces, which each interface is identified by an ID, like S0 or S1, or maybe it could even be a Cisco-style interface name, and then the IP address for that interface. And typically, when you have to configure BGP, these are the steps you would do. You would first create the interface, or you would assign IP addresses to it, and then you would create the OSPF areas, and then you would create the BGP instance and associate the router ID and the neighborhood information to that. And I'm going to do the same sequence. And for the router configuration, these are the two things I have. I have OSPF configuration and BGP configuration. I have only the basic, simplest parameters here. But typically, if you were to go buy a box or a router from Cisco, Juniper, or Alcatel Lucent, you also get their YAN model for that box. And once you have the YAN model, and of course, if they support IETF network monitoring, it will also export the YAN model automatically, and you wouldn't have to do this. Anyway, in my case, I'm just emulating, so I have a simple YAN model that I wrote. And for OSPF, I have a process ID, and I have a list of subnets it manages and the area ID for that. And for BGP, the AS number is the key, and I have a list of neighbors and the associated router ID for the neighbors. So this is the router model that every router I'm going to spin up will have, and then we're going to manage that or control that from OpenDaylight. Any questions with the YAN model? I used very simple primitives, as you can see. I just used strings and integers, and I have no groupings. I just flattened everything out because I was just doing something quick that I wanted to work. So here is my router model. I do have something from the morning. Let me just remove that. Okay. So right now, so inside OpenDaylight, there is a netconf client, which is which can be started by running this netconf connector. So let me start that. I started my account speaker. It usually generates the SSH key and things like that. It'll take like a few seconds and it'll say it's ready. Once it's ready, then we can spin up our routers and we can add it to the. Okay, it says Netcon connector is ready. Now what I'm going to do is, I inside the VM, I have a bunch of shell scripts. That shell script is doing nothing but it's spinning up a container and it's copying the custom YAN model into that container. So let me do that. I'm going to spawn a router. I'll call it router one. And it said what IP it gave to the router one, and I'm going to spin up another router called router two. So now I have two routers that have been spun up, and both of them have the same YAN model, which I showed you a few seconds ago. And they have the IP address of .2.3, and they are nothing but Docker containers. Here I have the two Docker containers for the network here, which is running the Netcom server. Now I have not yet registered, so let me show you my current view. So here is where you look up all the Netcon's devices that have been discovered. Right now there is just one Netcon device, which is basically the controller itself. As I said before, OpenDaylight is also uses Netcon extensively for internal management. So that is the first node. Now let's register the other nodes. So I need to register any new device, and for registering, you need to specify the These are the four few things I need to specify. You need to say what device name, the IP address, the username, and password, and things like that. So I'm going to now register to both of these Netcon devices, router one. What IP? Router one is dot two. Okay, I registered this. Let's see all the chunks that gets printed on the log. So on the console, you see that it connected successfully to this new device. So now I should be able to see this new device in my inventory. So in my it usually is inside the operational store in network topology netcon. So I have a new node that has been discovered, and for this particular node, router one, here are all the available capabilities. Now, capability basically translates to whatever YAN model it has support for. And the custom YAN model that I've put in is right here. So this just says that my Netcon device is going to support this YAN model. And there is a specific approach called the binding independent provider. When you go that approach, even if you don't already have the YAN model, you still would be able to modify the data store by directly going to the DOM. That's a more riskier and complicated way, and typically that's not recommended. But for cases where you don't have the YAN model for devices, those are ways in which you would approach that. But in our case, we have it, and I'm going to now that it's loaded and it's accessible, I'm going to configure this router. See, let me register the other one as well. Okay, so I registered both of these. Now I'm going to send all the configurations to this particular emulated router. So here is the model that I showed you, and here are the steps for registering and all that if you want to play with this on your own. Here are the configurations I'm going to send. I'm going to send for each of the router the appropriate OSPF ID, the subnet, and also the router ID. For this one is AS number 1000, and other one is AS number 2000. And I put them as neighbors to each other. Unfortunately, I don't have fog or anything. I don't have a routing stack running this. This is something one of my colleagues is helping me with, and maybe at a later version of the tutorial, we'll actually be able to set up a BGP session, but right now, it's all emulated. And let me send that configuration. So I Here are the discovered nodes. I have router 1 and router 2 that are discovered. Let me configure the Ethernet interface of router 1. Interface 1. And then here is the configuration I'm sending. So now that I've sent the configuration for router 1, let's query to see what all it has. You can see that it has a list of interfaces. It has also the router container, which has the OSPF and BGP information. So imagine how, from this you can get a sense that, anything I can do on RESTCONF, I could also do it through an application. So you can get a sense of how easy it should be to build an orchestrator using OpenDaylight, where you can actually configure an OpenFoot device and an RESTCONF device from the same platform, and they can share some state and you can have some global consensus in what you want to see. And one last thing before I move on. I do want to show you how this looks inside the router. So I'm now going inside the router one. As I said, there is a there's a CLI and NetConf inside the router, so I'm going to use that. Okay, I've logged in. Now here I can do NetConf operations. Like there are operations like get, I think there's a status. Yeah, I could check the status. It says that it's connected. And I can also get config. I need to say what data store I'm looking at. I'm looking at the running config. So here is the running config inside the router, the same configuration that was sent from the controller. So essentially, I was able to send configuration to this router from the orchestrator. And this morning, I was actually, unfortunately, I'm not done, but I haven't done testing, but I started building a simple router orchestrator application, which I will commit the code and I can send you a pointer to this. Essentially, what I was doing is, here is where I'm configuring the interface, but through a Java application inside OpenDaylight. So once the instantiation is done, so I'll come to the instantiation and all those parts shortly, but let's just assume everything is instantiated and someone is calling this configure dummy interface. What I want to really do is I want to write some configuration to this particular REST API. So what I would do is I would first construct an object for just this part of it, which is essentially called a mount point. So in the NetConf world, inside OpenDaylight, they call it a mount point. So I have to create a mount point for that particular router. And that's what I do here. This almost is like giving me a direct access to the data store, configuration data store for that router. So the step one is get access to the mount point. And the step two is now to start writing to that mount point. And in the step two, there are subparts, which is first thing is I'm going to get access to the data broker. The data broker is what we will use extensively in our tutorial later part today for actually writing any configuration into the data store. And data broker is essentially a MDSAL, as you can see, it says MDSAL binding API. It's an MDSAL service provided to us for writing data into the data store. So I first get a handle on the data store, on the data broker, and then I construct the data using the builders, and I also get a pointer to the location where I want to put this data. And then the last thing is I write the data to the config data store. So now this generic transaction utils is really one of my utilities that I wrote for just doing everything in one line. Now I'm just sending whatever I have my data broker, and I'm sending what data store I want to write it. This is the configuration data store. And I'm also saying which location to write it in and what data to write in. And once I provide that, it's going to write that configuration into the data store. So this is all that it took for me to actually, maybe a little bit more, the step one as well. So this is all that it takes to write a configuration into the NetConf device from my OpenDaylight orchestrator. And it's kind of same as what I did in the RESTConf, just that now it's in the application. Any questions with this NetConf exercise? Is it all straightforward? This is something that is really powerful, and we have been exploring this even inside Infinera, because I mean, clearly the world is not going to become an open flow driven world right away. So it's important to orchestrate both sides of the wire. So we are looking at how to use both NetConf and open flow together.
I have a question here on the NetConf.
Hmm?
Yes, for different vendor, is there a standard there, or they have to provide a NetConf young model for each different routers?
Unfortunately, right now, yeah, there is a specific Yang model for each device, and typically, there is this consortium or effort called OpenConfig. The goal of OpenConfig is really to make this more simpler and have a unified Yang model, at least for the common function. I mean, if you take a router configuration, I've configured several routers in the past. There are some things that you do just one time, but there are some things that you do more often. The things that you do more often is the ones that you really want to have in a common model across all the vendors, and that's what OpenConfig would provide. But it's early stages, and right now there are no vendors supporting that model, but someday you'll have that, and you'll be able to use that.
Okay.
Hey, Srini, this is Paul. I also have a question about the NetConf. So in the example you were giving, you just send the configuration to the data store. So who will be send the configuration to the device?
Yeah. So when I send it into the data store, it is picked up by the NetConf client, and it is going to basically it's actually registered as a listener, and it will take that configuration and it will send it down to the device. And similarly, I could also actually, in the NetConf world, there are RPC calls. You could also do RPC calls from the orchestrator down to the device. And that also is appropriately routed by MDSAL going through the NetConf client.
So for the approach you are using, the configuration to the device will be done automatically.
Yep, exactly. All that I did was I wrote the configuration to the data store, and magically that configuration appeared inside my device.
I see.
And it's handled by the NetConf client. One more thing that I do want to mention is that there is support in OpenDaylight for running a NetConf server as well. So the intention being that you create an intent layer, which is also based on NetConf, and you use the NetConf server for that. So what happens is you can actually speak NetConf on the northbound to the OpenDaylight controller, and then OpenDaylight controller will receive configurations and add it to the data store or let you do RPC calls. So that way, if you have another external orchestrator that speaks NetConf to OpenDaylight, you could also have that easily plugged in.
I see. Thank you.
Okay, cool. So let's move along. So now, let's go on to the actually looking at some pieces of the code and actually trying to build a project and an application. So I have the SDN Hub tutorial project kind of looks like this. There's a tap app and a learning switch application. And this morning I just added a NetConf application, but I've not committed that. I'll send that in. And there is also, it uses the MDSAL, but it also uses the OpenFlow plugin. And the OpenFlow plugin is one that programs the data plane. And the learning switch typically reacts to any packet in or packet out and programs the rules. The TAP application works on kind of different event handlers. It is a proactive application that basically takes configuration from the, I'll leave this pop-up. The TAP application takes user configuration from a high-level administrator or orchestration system. So if I send a TAP information like this, saying any traffic coming on source node connector OpenFlow 1.1, send it out of the sync node connector 1.2. And this This we do only for traffic that matches type of HTTP. So for if let's say this configuration is sent, the TAP application takes that configuration and translates that into a flow mode operation and goes about programming the underlying hardware. So essentially what I'm coming back to is that any application built in OpenDaylight is all about event-driven programming and data adaptation. And that's why this whole model-driven data adaptation and service abstraction is so important. So this is the goal of the application we're going to be building. So I want to receive this configuration and I want to program this configuration, which is kind of example similar to the rule that we sent a few minutes ago. The only exception is that you have additionally a HTTP match in the form of here you have the ether type, you have the destination TCP port and the IP match. So there are some extra match fields, but other stuff is kind of similar to what we did in the RESTCONF example. So I want to take this configuration and program the underlying device. So for doing that, the first thing I need to do, of course, is define the YAN model. So here is the YAN model for this TAP application. I have some basic guidelines that say what direction of traffic I want to be monitoring. Do I want to monitor the traffic? Should I monitor the source fields or do I monitor the destination fields or do I monitor both? And then the here are the list of traffic types that I want to support. And then here is the actual TAP configuration that I will be using. So here I have the list of TAPs, each of them identified by some random string identifier, and it uses the grouping called TAP grouping, which is defined on the right side here. Now the TAP grouping has says exactly which device and what are the list of source connectors. Initially, we will just do with just one source and one sync, but later I hope you will take some time and try to actually expand it to multiple sources and multiple syncs. So for a single source, single sync, or a source and sync, so here I have a list of leaf refs. There was a question yesterday about references to other models. So here is a reference to the OpenDaylight inventory. So instead of trying to say what node connector I want to use and trying to actually define the node connector here, I'm just putting a reference to the inventory. And what that does is it ensures that whenever I get a configuration, it does some basic validation and ensures that I only get a node connector that is actually valid. And then I also get a list of references to sync node connectors. And then I have a MAC address matching, and the IP address matching, and the traffic matching. Now, there is some similarity with OpenFlow, but I'm trying to define the application, not really OpenFlow specific. So now once I get the configuration in this form, I need to make the adaptation to convert that into the OpenFlow form. And that's what the application we'll be doing will focus on. Any questions on this model? And I circled this, or I highlighted this particular box in yellow, just to indicate that this is really the container that stores all the information. So in OpenDaylight data store, a container is needs to be a root addressable part of the tree, and that, I mean, the root of the tree should be a container. So as we talked about step one, step two, and step three, step one is to define the YAN model. Step two is to put in the activation stuff, which we will look at shortly. And step three is to handle the event. And the kind of events that I really am going to be handling is the data change events. Basically, when a configuration comes from a high-level end user, I'm going to handle this on data change. And you'll start noticing a lot of boilerplate code, which is kind of similar looking for many applications. And that's kind of common with Java and with the way these interfaces and these services are structured. So the first time it's going to look really Greek and complicated, but once you do one application, you'll notice that it's going to be so much more simpler the next time around. And because of defining all your data beforehand in Yang and everything compiled and auto-generated, you're going to notice that you'll make fewer and fewer mistakes when you in your compile and runtime, because your data is very structured, and you also can use the autocomplete in your IDE to ensure that you don't make any mistakes. So let's look at the event handlers I have here. So let's just say someone somewhere calls the constructor of this. So here is a Java class called tutorial task provider, and someone is calling the constructor and constructs this class, this object. And the first thing I would do is I would register the data change listener for any task configuration. Once I do that, whenever a new configuration comes in, the on data change is going to be called, and that's going to have a couple of different objects inside this change. So this change is a complex data structure which has new data that has been created, and it also has anything that has been deleted. It has the original data and the removed data. So there are a lot of information in this, and you need to parse through that to find out exactly what is part of this change. And it is possible that each change has like multiple individual data objects that have been removed or added. So it is almost like a more cumulative change. So you need to pass through every single one of them. And that's why I have a for loop here. So the first for loop iterates over any created information, any created configuration. And the second for loop iterates over any deleted configuration. And whenever, so the first thing I would do is I would get access to the data object and see whether this is really a task configuration, because it is possible that I have some configuration that has nothing to do with that. Maybe it's something to do with the BTP information, which this provider should not worry about. In that case, I'm just going to check, ensure, do a double check and ensure that the data object that now has changed is actually an instance of the task configuration. If it is, then I would go about programming the task. But if in case, and when I go through the delete one, if I get a delete operation and the data object is of task, then I appropriately call the remove task. So in our example, we are going to kind of fill in the blanks for this to do 1, 2, and 3. And in the process, we'll try to kind of get a hang of what app development means. So before going to that, I'll definitely focus a little bit on the activation part and also the transaction part, because those are going to be fundamentals for any application you build. And then after that, we'll come into these pieces. And just to remind you, the goal is essentially to convert from configuration that looks like this into an open flow configuration, which you can send down to the plugin. And of course, it could have as well been a netconf configuration as well. OK, so now, actually, let me clear out my netconf. I don't need this stuff anymore. So let me start the mini-init. So let's look at the task implementation function. So in here, I have the So let's start with the activation part. So I have a Yang file here, which says exactly what this task is going to need. It says what is the prefix of the Java class that is going to be used, is going to be part of the name of the auto-generated module. And then it also specifies what all services I'm going to use. Initially, I don't really know, so whenever I write an application, I end up having all three of these, but sometimes you notice that you won't need all of them. So I have, I say here that I'm going to use the data broker for any data changes. I'm going to use notification, and I'm going to use RPC registry for making or receiving RPC calls. So after I provide this basic skeleton configuration to the config subsystem, I also need to have a config file that has a similar information that also says what are my dependencies. So here I say that my particular application has a dependency on loading the tap app impl, and it also has dependency on loading the OpenFlow provider. So unless both of these are successfully loaded, both of these bundles are successfully loaded, the config subsystem will not really say that it has been successfully instantiated. So these are basically boilerplate stuff. At this point, I would just suggest you copy over from existing modules and rename things, and ensure that whenever you do that, update your revision number accordingly so that you don't have a conflict or you don't have a missing or mismatch or any of that. So these configurations are these two pieces are kind of standard. So once you do that and you compile, what happens is that it generates automatically some bunch of files. Specifically, it generates these three files here. So these three files are auto-generated. But of the auto-generated ones, this tutorial app module is the one we are actually supposed to modify, and that's what I've done here. So I have my tutorial app module.java, and inside that, when I first compile, what it's going to do is it's just going to look like this. When you auto-generate, your code is going to look like this. And this create instance is the one that I need to actually change, and I need to add my code. And the code I'm adding is essentially getting access to all the mdsol services, and I'm checking that they are not null. And then I provide that mdsol services to my other helper class called tap provider. So the tap provider, the constructor I'm calling with all the three mdsol services that I would be using. And once that is done, I say it's initialized, and I return that object. And tap provider's constructor automatically gets called, like I said. So essentially, this is how you instantiate any module. Just to recap, you need to write these two files, the implementation.yang and config.xml. And then once you do that and you compile, it's going to auto-generate these three functions classes here, of which the tap app module is the one you have to modify. And it will have a method inside that called create instance. You need to go inside the create instance and you need to add this code right there, which basically gets access to all the mdsol services, and it provides that to any other helper class you would be using. So this is how you go about instantiating your application. And if I look at my log history, let's see. So I do have here a line here that says my tap app has been initialized. Essentially what that means is that all the dependencies were resolved and my config subsystem was able to find the appropriate capabilities that is needed, and everything is good to go. And it called that create instance function, and the create instance function constructed the helper class, and it was done with what it had to do. Now after this point, everything is going to be event driven, and there's going to be the controller is going to just be doing nothing and waiting for you. You can almost, at least in my laptop, I can see that by once I start the controller for almost like a minute, my laptop is pretty loud, and after a minute, it just comes on and waits for any other configuration that comes from me. And so here, in my helper class, I have a couple of things I've done. One is I have implemented this OpenDaylight inventory listener. So I have, appropriately, I have here the on node updated, the on node removed, and all of that. So I just have a bunch of print statements in the on node updated. This is similar to the code I showed in the PowerPoint, where it basically, once a node comes up, I remove all the flow using the RPC call. So if you recollect, I stopped my mininet. Let me start it again. So So once I start mininet, what's going to happen is that a new notification is going to come to this particular callback function, and this callback function is going to print saying node updated, and it's also going to print the OpenFlow description for that, assuming it's an OpenFlow node. So here I have a check to see, is it an OpenFlow node? If it is, then it prints that information. So let's start the OpenFlow node. Okay, you see here a bunch of information that got printed. So here is, it's this one here. So a new node has been discovered, and here is the port description, the name of that node, and all that information is right here. So this is coming basically from that callback function, which got called once that node connected to the controller. So in this part, I just wanted you to look at this notification. Same way, let me change my log level to debug. Now I can stop this mininet, and you will see that you'll get a disconnection. I am checking. So here it says node removed. So whenever you remove a node, that gets printed. So here I'm just showing you how these callbacks work. Now let's go on to let's start it again. And so now I have this node created. So we're done with the notification part. Now let's look at the other part, which is the data change listening. Now, whenever the first step to do is to register my data change listener. So I'm using this function here called register data change listener. And what that does is essentially it creates an instance identifier, which is a pointer to the configuration data store for this task information. And it is registering this particular helper class or helper object, this one to that particular instance identifier. So once that is done, it prints that data change listener registered. So the first step to really getting any data change is first to register, and only after you do that, your callback function on data change is going to get called. So here I have my on data change, and I just have some log being printed thing added and removed. So let's give this a spin and see what happens, so that you can see this callback function as well. So okay, now I have my app is running, and I have no code inside that except for some log printing. I'm going to now send a task configuration using my REST conf. So here is let me just get my IP phone. Okay, there are no tabs configured. I'm going to add just one tab, which is same as what I showed in the PowerPoint, which basically says source is OpenFlow 1.1 and sync is OpenFlow 1.2. And let's send this information, and traffic matches HTTP. So once I send this, let me get all configured tabs. You can see, when I see the configured tabs, I have this one tab that has been configured, and then I also see here a callback thing being printed for a new information being added for the tab. One point I want you to note here is there are two notifications sent here. The first one is actually for the high-level container called tab spec, while the second one is for the specific tab that was added. You could handle either one of them as long as you iterate through the individual tabs and you configure each of the tabs. So these are some things to watch out for. Sometimes you could make a mistake on this. And the other thing is also during deletion, if let's say someone deletes the root container, which is the whole tab spec, then you're going to get not only a remove operation for the individual tabs, you're also going to get one for the overall container. So there could be some logical sequencing behind all this that you should watch out for. So there is also another kind of a notification which has been recently added in Lithium. It's called a data tree listener. Instead of a data chain listener, there's a data tree listener, and that one gives you things in a specific order, and so that is highly recommended. In my tutorial, doesn't use that, but I would encourage you to use that in the future. So here I have the configuration that came in. We could also delete this and see what happens. That one, deletion, IP. Okay, I deleted the star, and then I got a notification for the tar being removed, and also I got a notification for the task spec, which is a high level container, being updated. So there are three things added, removed, and updated, and based on what your application needs, you should handle whichever one. And of course, this is for data change notification. For a RPC call, it will be 1:1, and you can directly hook it up with the appropriate function. Like for instance, I have here, okay, I guess I don't have it in this example, but you could also add a RPC function called create tap or remove tap, and you can have response directly call that. But in any case, even whether it's coming, the configuration is coming through a data change or through a RPC, you still have to do this particular step, converting from a tap data to the OpenFlow data. Any questions so far? So I've so far showed you the instantiation piece. I've shown you the notification listener for OpenDaylight node or switch discovery and things like that. I've also shown you the data change notification and the three types of data changes you would receive, which are basically the created, removed, and updated. And each of them you will handle appropriately by calling helper functions or whatever. Any questions with this?
Yeah, makes sense so far, except we have to try it out ourselves.
Exactly. You have to try it out yourself, and I think, I used to be a Java instructor for many years, and I think there are some things that you could just take for granted and on day one say, okay, this is public static main because it is public static main, and not question it and just do it that way and get the hang of the platform. But at some point, you will want to know what is public, what is static, and what is void. So you will get to that point, but initially you may just want to use certain boilerplate code and see how it works and get the hang of the platform, and then at some point, you will start realizing exactly why each of these are triggered. So now, for this last piece, our goal is fairly clear. We need to now adapt from one data format to the other and send it down to the switch. I have some skeleton code here, but it's really not complete, and it uses a lot of these utils. So before going into the skeleton code, I want to focus a little bit on the utilities. Specifically, I want to focus on my generic transaction utils that I have. That actually has been a lifesaver in making my code look a little bit prettier and also helps speed up my implementation. So I have two functions inside my generic transaction utils. The first one is read data, second is write data. And it takes as arguments the data broker or object of the data broker, which is the MDSAL service, and then it says which data store I want to modify. And then is the instance identifier, which is the pointer to that particular point in the tree. And then here is the exact data that we are really going to be adding. So here is the write data function. And I'm using the same function for both the adding and the deleting. If the Boolean variable is true, then it's add. If it's false, then it's a delete. So here I have, the first thing I do is I create a transaction. I create a write transaction. And if it is add, I also do an additional verification to see if the data object is not null. And once I do that check, I'm doing a modification.merge. So there are two kinds of transactions you can do. One, a write transaction. One is a merge, and other is a put. A put is actually something that is you can think of as a replay. Like it's going to delete what is already there and then put this new one in that location. While a merge is going to actually merge the fields in a more intelligent way. This could also be very tricky and get you in trouble if you actually use a put and you don't realize that it's going to delete some fields that you didn't already have populated. So there are two things. You could do a merge or put. Using an ID is very important because I could actually do modification dot, and it's going to provide me all the options possible. Like you could see that I have a modification dot cancel, modification commit, and I have a modification merge and a modification put. So the sequence I have to do is I need to first do the merge or the put, and then I would do modification dot submit. And if there is any exception, then I would do modification cancel. So these are the three steps you have to do when you are going to make any data change in your data store. And this code is fairly common. I mean, you would use it very often, so that's why I've used it for different using standard template library. I've used it for different different data objects. I use the same function. And so the first thing I do is merge, and then I do submit. If it's a delete, then I do a delete and then a submit. And let's look at the read operation. The read is a little bit different, where you have a case where you may or may not get data. So we use, so in OpenDaylight they use the construct called optional, which is from the Guava libraries of Google, where you first get an optional object and then you check if the data is available. If it is there, then you extract the data, you typecast it to whatever type you want, and you return it. If the data is not there, then you return null. So I have these two functions, read data and write data, and I will use that extensively in all my apps in this tutorial as well. And this is how you make any transaction with the data store. And I'm not going to go over the match utils and the action utils. They are fairly straightforward for OpenFlow programming. Here are some of the examples of what all one could do. I could do match utils. I first do a match builder and I create a basic match object. And then I provide that match builder to add on either an Ethernet source match or a destination MAC address match, or a source IP address match or a destination IP address match, or a type match and things like that. So the piece that is missing here is, how do I convert from, here's the logic here. I need to extract the header details and figure out exactly what does it mean when I say the traffic I want to match is HTTP. So this is where some level of programming logic comes in. And I have a solution file inside here. So inside my TAP application, I have a solution file for different approaches and different solutions. You can look at that, but I also have the same inside the tutorial page as well for OpenDaylight. So I need to convert the traffic match from one type to the other. So here's a tutorial page that kind of goes through the same kind of sequence of what I've been talking about. Here is the real core logic that I need. I need to convert a particular traffic type from one traffic match, which is a type R or whatever, to the appropriate header field values. So this is the logic that you have to build. And once you have this logic, then it becomes a matter of almost creating just the flow object and making transactions. So this is what I do here. Inside the program tab, the first thing I'm going to do is figure out exactly what fields I want. So just to speed up my process, I'm going to just copy paste from here to there. So I've now copied the header fields here. So what this does is, so if I, yeah, actually that's another point I want to show. So let's look at TAP object. The TAP object that I got is a YAN modeled object, and I can look at all the fields it has. It has a key field, it has a ID, it also has the exact node, the SYNC connector list, and the source connector list, and also the traffic match and all that. And if you want to look even more deeper, you can go into this tab and press F3. When I press F3, it's going to go and get the definition from the source code, which is actually, this is the auto-generated code from YAN tools. And here's the actual YAN model here, the flattened YAN model that I use. And I can also go into the tab builder, and that will give you even more information of exact fields that we are using. So let me show you the tab builder. I press F3, and here are the fields inside the tab builder. So it has same things like the ID key and the match values. So these are auto-generated things that it will auto-complete for you in the ID. So if, let's say, you are building something, I could have as well just I could have done tab dot and look for which one I want to match, and it's going to give me the traffic match. I'm sure most of you have used these IDEs, but I just want to point out that all the YAN model files will also be searchable inside the IDE, and you'll be able to do autocomplete. And this ensures much fewer error in your programming. So anything you send from REST API, you know that you are actually handling the right fields. So now I've broken up the traffic match into individual fields. Now I need to convert that into OpenFlow values. So the first thing, let's do the match. Let me remove these to do here. These are not actually 1:1 matching. I need to go over these a little bit. So okay, first thing is I'm setting the match value. It is source mat. Okay, what is my source mat here? Source mat is inside the tab. So let's do the source mat. So if tab dot get mac address match dot get value, if this one if this not equals null, then I create a source mac, which is going to be the tab value. So here, so it also helps you import stuff. So your import also, there is a lot of help here. Okay, so I've taken care of matching on my first field, which is my source MAC. I first extracted the exact MAC address, and I sent a create source MAC address match to the match builder. Kind of in a similar way, I would do for the same things. But right now, if you recollect one thing, in my model, I have a slightly complicated model where I have directionality. I say source and destination. So let's just handle only the source for now. And just let's just assume that any MAC address provided is a source MAC address. And same I'll do for IP address as well. If IP if IP match is not null, then I need the prefix. Essentially, you can see the definition of this create source MAC. It takes as argument an IPv4 prefix, so I need a IPv4 prefix. So you could construct the object just like in the same way. For now, I'm actually going to ignore the IP fields. In our example, anyway, we don't use it. So I'll leave this for you to finish. I'll remove the destination. The ether type I need, because if you see here, I have the network protocol and the ether type, which are important parts of the match. So we need all these things. So I'm going to bring those values. Let's again ignore the source part of it. We just have okay. So So I'm matching on the destination, the TCP or the transport port number, and then the DL type, something not right here. Create method, okay, it's looking for a long. What do I have here? I have an integer. So maybe I do DL type dot long value, and now I have a long value. So anyway, I really expanded all this real estate in Java. What I did was basically create the match object. And now that I did the match object, I can now create the import. If there's a list of source node connectors, then you would have to actually iterate over it and have a for loop. But for now, I'm going to assume there is only one. So let's just do dot source node connector dot tap dot get source node connector dot get zero. I'm just going to get only the first one, and I'm going to program that. So I have the import match as well. I have some code here which is actually fairly annoying and straightforward. What is this doing? It is creating the whole tree of the instruction. I have a list of instruction. Each instruction can be of type apply instruction or write instruction. And then each instruction has a list of actions, and each action can be of different types. And I'm going to use the output type here. So we're done with the match, and now I'm doing the action part. And I could do for each sync node connector, but for now, I only have one in my example. So let's just keep this as is. Anyway, it's going to iterate and run through that only one time. So now I've kind of finished the code for the adding of the tap. Once I finish the instruction, I have to create the actual flow object. For that, I use a flow builder. The definition of the flow builder, you can press F3 and you can get. If let's say I don't have it locally, it's going to download from the public repository. So here it downloaded and I have the full set of fields that I need, and I can go about populating that. And so I have the barrier values, the table ID and key and things like that. Pretty much same as what I programmed in our first example. So if you look at my first open flow programming example of creating a dummy flow, I had my table value and my flow ID and things like that. We're going to kind of create all the same thing, but just that now we are doing it inside Java. So the last thing, once I finish my match and my action and creating the flow object, is to create my pointer to exactly where it needs to be put. And this pointer is basically similar to what I have right here, this REST API. So it says here the node, and then it says here the table ID, and here it says the flow name. And all of those things are what I would need. I have the table, I have the flow name, and then I have the exact node I'm going to be programming on. Once I do that, I call my generic utils and do write data, and it's going to write it. So let's see this one in action. I don't see any compilation errors in my IDE, but I need to stop and start. So let's do that. It's just going to take a couple of minutes. In the meantime, if you have any questions on the code or any of what I did, I'd love to go over that. Okay, there are no rules in my mininet switch. I'm just recompiling my code. Previously, what happened was whenever I sent a configuration from my restconf, nothing happened. It just kept printing a log value, but this time it's hopefully going to program a rule. And the essential constructs you need to remember are the notification handlers, the callbacks for that, the data change listener. And if you're doing RPC call, then you need to handle the RPC call for that. In the meantime, when compiling, I can show you just one more thing in the model here. I have the tap model. If I want to add a RPC, it's very simple. Yesterday, someone had a question on what is the benefit of defining a tap grouping. The benefit is that I could actually now reuse that. I could actually create a RPC call create tap, inside which I say my input value is going to be uses tap grouping, and output I could just maybe I could just return output just a string with which is the ID of the tap. Maybe I call it tap ID, and it is of type string. So once I do this, now I have finished providing a support for the create tap. I just have to go inside my code and add the handler for the create tap function call. So this is the reason why, I mean, the handler for the data change and the RPC often tends to be similar, but just that they represent different mechanisms. It's not a 1:1 relationship. Okay, now let's start our application again. Let's wait until we see the line saying initialized. Once it's initialized, then I'll send the tap configuration. So it is doing a lot of things here, which involves kicking off the LLTP speaker, which is for link detection. It also kicks off a bunch of stuff for Akka. Akka is the one that is done for persistence. And like I said yesterday, in the assembly, now there is a directory called journal that is created. A journal has all the configuration. Right now it has some basic config. It is in a in just a, they call it, I think, I forgot the, it's some Akka's own DB file, DB format. And if you want to reset your system, you should always remove the journal, data, and the snapshot, all three of those directories. Otherwise, you'll have some remnant data from the earlier run. So now I have my system, my tab is initialized. So let's go about pushing rules. So I'm sending one configuration. It went in. I don't see it here because, I think I missed the part of uncommenting. Yeah, I finished the program tab, but I forgot to call it here. Program tab. I should delete the tab, create tab thing. This run location is just a symbolic link that I added for just not having to type everything next time. So I'm just recompiling. Last chance for a question. So I after this program is based on programming, I'll stop for today, and I would encourage you to look at the learning switch example. And here it handles the packet receipt and the transmit packet RCP. RPC. And you could also do an augmentation where in the learning switch you can keep augmenting your inventory with a list of MAC addresses that have been learned, or even the association between MAC address and port number. You can store it inside the inventory. So I have an example of the augmentation that I've defined. You can give this a try and see how we can add a MAC table into your inventory for a particular switch. So I have some examples, and there are some skeleton code again even for this one inside the learning switch project. So have a look at that. And here is the link for the tutorial where you could go about looking at the sequence all over again, and there is some code helpers there as well. And the next day, which I think Vijay also mentioned, we need to figure out the exact date. For the next day, I will go over some of the MDSAL clustering aspects. So one of the important things with data store is the replication and clustering, and what does it mean when you have multiple instances of the controller? What does it mean for notification? What does it mean for data changes? So I will go over that. And I will also go over the intent and the concept from the intent project. And we could also have that as a smaller session and just make it a Q&A for anything that architecturally would be relevant for what you guys are looking at, and if you have specific questions on what would be the best practices, and hopefully you may also have some questions from trying this stuff out, so we can do that. So maybe at least a 1 hour session is what I think would be good, like a more complete wrap up of some of the advanced concepts and also looking at any other questions on whatever else you guys need. Vijay, you mentioned that maybe challenges for this Friday. Did you want to, I guess you'll run it by your team and let me know of a different date.
Yeah, so let me first stop recording.
Okay, now that I've compiled OpenDaylight and I have the appropriate functions call, now let's do the Postman thing again. So now I send the configurations. Ooh, I have an exception now. okay. This is going to be iterative. And first case, this is one of the caveats. So I got a data chain notification for the high-level container, and that caused my thing to crash. I should have, before I typecasted, I should have checked, is it off-site, is it off-instance, if data object instance off tab, then I program tab would be. Anyway, I think so. These are some of the pitfalls you should also watch out for. I promise you, I mean, it's very simple enough. I promise you the rule is going to get programmed and it's fairly straightforward. But the concepts I do want to point out is that you handle events, and specifically you handle data changes where configurations come in, and then you translate the data from one form, which is my tab configuration, to an open flow form, and then that programs the rule. So this is essentially what almost most of open data programming would entail. And there is a bit of a learning curve, but once you get the hang of all these tools of Maven and things like that, it's a lot easier. And one last thing I want to point out is there is a debugger here where I could click on debug configuration, and I can click on remote Java app and create a, and I click on view and enter the port number, which is 5005. And once you click debug, it's going to attach a debugger onto my system. So I can actually add a breakpoint wherever I want, and I can break my execution at that point, and I can inspect the data to see exactly what configuration I got, and if maybe the user sent a wrong invalid configuration. So there's also good debugger facilities inside IDEs, which you can very well use with Karaf. And there is an option called Karaf debug that you need to enable for that. And in the tutorial VM, it's already enabled. Any other questions while this recompiles? If not, I'll just wait a couple more minutes just for the recording sake. I want to just finish up and show the rule being programmed, and then we can call it a day. So in my system, in my VM, it's only I've only allocated 2 gigabytes and 2 CPU cores. I'm sure it'll be a little bit faster if you allocate 4. I think that might be a better thing to do in the longer run when you are building your own applications. And these console commands on Karaf the log and the bundle and the feature. Those are the three ones that come really handy in seeing if the right things are instantiated and also for checking out the logs. And all the logs get stashed away inside the data log directory, and it automatically log rotates, and there are only 10 logs maintained. So you could keep looking at historical information right there. And any other configurations that you want to add or you want to provide externally from external system, which is like a, which you don't want to go through REST and you want to just provide an XML configuration, you could do that inside etc. There are a lot of configs right here. You could add custom ones as well. So that makes it easier to load external configs. Okay, my module is initialized. Hopefully this time around, I have got the flow programming done right. Okay, so here you see the flow program which says basically input one HTTP traffic, go to output two. So it handles the appropriate data change notification and it programs the rule. So this is essentially what you would do with OpenDaylight. Any other questions with app development? Feel free to drop me a mail. My email address was shared in the slide deck. And if you have specific questions when you're trying this out, I definitely encourage you to try this out yourself and either build a simple tap or you can even go really wild and build your own new application. Maybe you can build a firewall or you can you could build a load balancer. I mean, there are examples for all of this online, so you may be able to find that and implement one. Great. I guess if you have no other questions, then I'll wrap up and look forward to the wrap-up session where we'll go over some of the advanced concepts.
Okay. Thank you very much. And once we decide the final session, I'll send up the updated invite.
Okay. Thanks, Jay.
Sure, no problem.